for tuning in on tonight's webinar. This will be hopefully the first of many webinars hosted by EBFA in 2012. I see some familiar names, so welcome to all of you. If you are new to EBFA, special thank you and welcome to you. If you are unfamiliar with who I am, my name is Dr. Emily Splichal. I am the founder of EBFA. I am a podiatrist by day and hold a master's in human movement, have been in the fitness industry for over 11 years, holding NASM, NSCA, and various group fitness certifications. So why I wanted to do a webinar on barefoot training guidelines is to really start tapping into this idea of barefoot training. I think that this is the perfect opportunity. The fitness industry has embraced this idea of foot fitness and barefoot training. We have a lot of barefoot training group fitness programs. If you look at the 2012 fitness conference lineup, we have a lot of foot fitness and barefoot geared programs. But again,
muted.
So there is an area that you can ask questions. Sorry. There's an area that you can ask questions, and we will be doing, I'll be speaking for about 20 minutes, and then the last 10 minutes, I will be going over some questions that maybe you guys have on the new Barefoot Training Specialist course from EBFA or barefoot training in general. This is not about barefoot running, so I want that to be very clear. This is exploring the concept of barefoot training itself. So as we move forward, just real quick, if you are unfamiliar with EBFA or Evidence-Based Fitness Academy, it is a continuing education institute that provides evidence-based continuing education to health and fitness professionals. Because I'm a podiatrist, all of the courses and foundation courses from EBFA are about the foot and ankle barefoot training and closed chain kinematics. I encourage you to look at our website and check out some of the new exciting courses we have for 2012. I also have a blog that I write supposed to be every week, but every couple weeks, and I write some evidence-based articles on the foot and the ankle, barefoot training, and exercise science in general. So you might find some good articles in there. So going into the actual webinar, most important question that we need to ask is barefoot better? Being a podiatrist and being very much involved in the podiatric community, a lot of podiatrists would probably say no and would want you to slide in those $500 orthotics, put in those motion-controlled shock-absorbing shoes where we spend a lot of technology creating those shoes that maybe it is not better to be barefoot. I take a different perspective and truly believe that the foot was designed to support itself and has this innate loading response that it can absorb shock absorption on its own without that $100 shoe, that our foot is designed to control our total body alignment from the knees to the hips to the lower back, that our foot is designed to be our foundation to human movement and posture. So I truly do believe that there is a power in barefoot training, again, as we look at it from corrective exercise, functional training, and sports performance. So I had mentioned earlier that the fitness industry has begun to embrace this concept of barefoot training. Going to any health club, you will see Vibrams, Nike Freeze, Puma Minimalist shoes. We have barefoot group fitness classes. Again, the 2012 fitness lineup has a lot of foot-based lectures, but I think this is the best time to start looking at barefoot training as a program in itself. Barefoot training, foot-specific programs, so that we can start getting the most out of our corrective exercise, functional training, and sports performance programs. So, let's begin to explore that concept, how we can make it effective, how we can make it safe, and how we can achieve our goals by looking at foot-specific, evidence-based barefoot training. So, if you have not taken one of my foot courses yet, I encourage you to do so. We'll tap in a little bit about the foot and the ankle to start building an appreciation of how our foot is the foundation to human movement. So, first important role that the foot and ankle plays is in balance and proprioception, specifically in the plantar cutaneous receptors, or the skin on the bottom of the foot plays a very important role in posture, stability, and body alignment. Toe grip strength plays a very important role in balance and stability. There's a very interesting study that showed that seniors with the strongest toe strength reported the least number of falls. So that's an interesting concept. If you want to start creating evidence-based barefoot training programs and understand this association between the barefoot and balance and proprioception. Second role that the foot and the ankle plays in foundation to human movement is in the dissipation of ground reaction forces. And this is the most interesting thing, and this is kind of where the whole minimalist shoe and barefoot running movement kind of came from, is that our foot has this innate ability to absorb shock. From the way that we strike the ground, to the eccentric contraction of the posterior tibialis, to the contraction of the intrinsic muscles on the bottom of the foot. So if we understand these three important roles that the foot plays in ground reaction forces and the dissipation of these forces, we will better be able to create evidence-based barefoot training programs. Last role that the foot and the ankle plays, again in posture and alignment and human movement, is in lower extremity alignment. So there's a rotation between the foot and the lower leg, so they kind of married relationship. Whatever my foot is doing, the leg has to have an opposite movement. If I am able to reduce my athlete's ACL injury risk by looking at the foot and the ankle or the specific foot type that my athlete has and design an evidence-based barefoot training program off of that, I would better be able to reduce that specific athlete's ACL injury risk. If I have a client who has chronic low back pain and I do not look at their feet, it may be the feet that is leading to a compensation low back pain. Perhaps they do have a secondary gluteal amnesia where the driving force is the foot posture. I have a low back course where I speak about the association between different foot types and low back pain. And I try and encourage the fitness professionals who take these workshops to get their client's shoes off, look at the foot types, and see if the driving force behind that low back pain and perhaps that gluteal amnesia, maybe they have SI joint pain, is coming from their foot. So if that is the case, in that client's evidence-based barefoot training program, perhaps we should be integrating some posterior tibialis strengthening, some gluteus medius strengthening to try and correct that flat foot or rear foot pronation, and that then in itself will correct the rest of the lower extremity and get that client out of that gluteal amnesia and chronic low back pain. So we go then to our question, are barefoot training guidelines necessary. And this is something that I truly believe and am very passionate about, is that there are now a lot of emerging barefoot training classes and courses and workshops. Let's get out of our shoes and start doing things barefoot, but how do we do it safe? And I think the most important thing to creating safe and effective barefoot training programs is understanding the many unique foot types that are out there and the unique needs of each foot type. So I get a lot of referrals of people who are starting to do barefoot training programs. I have one patient in specific who was an avid barefoot runner, and she started doing these foot mobilization exercises, knew that, you know, stretch your calves, stretch your posterior tibialis, and having a mobile foot is better than a rigid foot. She's a barefoot runner, and she injures herself. Comes to me, and I know exactly